Good evening and welcome to the 6th Raja Chelliah Memorial Lecture, which is organized by NIPFP, the institution founded in 1976, in his memory and honor. I want to start by again expressing a special welcome to Mrs. Chelliah, and no longer Miss, but the former Mrs. Chelliah, who have very kindly joined us all the way from Chennai to be with us on this important day. I think I speak for everyone when I say that Dr. Chelliah is probably the doyen of Indian public finance in historical record. His work as an economist shaping policy through into the times of liberalization, his setting up of important institutions like my own and the Madras School of Economics, his willingness to bring the best of the rather his ability to bring the best in the world to apply their minds to India's economic problems and fiscal problems, his ability to see that public finance had, you know, important dimensions of political economy, all these things mark him up as truly someone who I'm very proud has founded the institution which I'm privileged to serve now. This institution he founded in IPFP is a autonomous institute of the Ministry of Finance, which sounds like an oxymoron, but it isn't. It is a public institution, and not just because of the funding, because it works on issues of public policy. It is a not-for-profit, and it places its services on a priority basis at the disposal of the governments of India, which is the government of India at the center and the governments of the states. In this process, I'm very happy to say that in my own tenure in 5 years, I have been involved in working with 23 states in just 5 years. And of course, we work a lot with the Ministry of Finance, the Department of Economic Affairs, the Department of Revenue, the Department of Expenditure. Many of our professors serve on important committees, and many more of our professors and economists do unglamorous but important work like helping reshape expenditure classifications, looking at ways and means advances, etc. We've also, of course, starting with our chairperson, many of our colleagues have served on government committees and commissions of some importance. It's quite amusing that whenever the Finance Commission is set up, and actually we have to be very careful that it minimizes its engagement with that commission in terms of members. Otherwise, like what happened last time, we don't get any research service from them except a token paper or two. And regrettably, that has been the case now for two or three finance commissions because they always have lots of members or chairpersons. So it is also my privilege today, before I hand over to Dr. Vijay Kekkar, our chairperson, to chair the session, to welcome our speaker and guest of honor, Dr. YVNG. Dr. Y, I'm going to steal from my chairperson as I've done across our association. Dr. YV Reddy is not just a complete economist, that he is. He is also in every sense a complete economic administrator, in that he has both served in and led every single fiscal and monetary institution of note that this country has in its architecture to date. And since we worked with the states, I think one of the most significant and important things is that Dr. Reddy worked with the government of Madhya Pradesh as finance secretary early on in his career, and then moved on to working with the government of India, Department of the Ministry of Finance, of course. Then was RED in Washington. I think before that, he was deputy governor, of course, and then governor of the Central Bank. And then finally, chairperson of the 14th Finance Commission. So that's as complete a 360-degree profile you can get of India's fiscal and monetary architecture. Which makes this topic very interesting because this is one of the subjects which everyone mentions, like small and medium enterprises. But no one quite knows what to say, having said there must be interlinkages between fiscal and monetary policy. I'll end with a small personal anecdote, which Dr. Reddy has forgotten, but I remember very vividly. When I served the UN in New York, back in 2003, it was 2004, there was a cafe in the UN Secretariat. And I'd gone there for a cup of coffee, and I saw this Indian gentleman across the aisle. I went and said hello, and I talked to him. I said, so where do you work? Are you in the UN? He said, no, I'm in the IMF. He said, no, I'm the IMF focal point. What do you do there? He said, well, I work for South Asia. I said, no, are you in fiscal affairs? Or are you, very reluctantly, he didn't say anything, but we exchanged cards. And I said, oh my God, we're basically directed for India, we never mentioned it. So, you know, things you've done to so many people who have told me this, that people never forget these things, but that willingness to engage and be open and interact irrespective of rank or post is something that in our country, which has still remains true, I think is there. And I think it's also a personal hallmark of excellence in scholarship and research and leadership that Dr. Reddy shows. So welcome, Dr. Reddy, and we look forward to your talk. I'd like to present, I always forget doing this because I'm not used to it yet, but please, as a token of appreciation, I would like to present you with a small offering of flowers.
Chairperson who gets a bouquet.
My very good friend and senior colleague, Dr. Reddy, the director of NIPFP, Dr. Roy, Srimati Chelliah, family members, friends. On my behalf, first I want to extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Reddy to this evening's event. Mr. Chelliah, this is NIPFP considered the most important part of our calendar in this lecture. And it's very, very heartwarming to see Dr. Reddy deliver this lecture. Before I make my further remarks, I would also mention that our finance minister was going to preside over this function. But last minute, he was summoned by his boss, so he has asked me to convey to the spirit of Mrs. Chelliah his inability, and also to Dr. Reddy, that explain to you why he cannot come. Doctor, I've seen Dr. Reddy in different avatars over the last 40 years. Many times we were partners in crime. Many places we were sinners, but every time one met, one was really very, very sort of received and given great warmth and friendship by Dr. Reddy. So I'm truly, truly happy that he accepted the invitation of his. Rashmi Nodi, given the CV of the history, CV, I just want to add only one point. In India, of course, the central bank government is extremely honored and important person, but there are very few Indian central bankers that have been internationally honored, and like, I can think of three, maybe there are more, but I can think of only three. Which was for the first Indian governor, Mr. Deshmukh, second Dr. Ajay Patel, and third Dr. Reddy, who is not only respected in India, but also respected in their community and in China community. So this is really a man of absolute rare achievement we have this evening of our country. So before any further remarks, I would invite Dr. Reddy for a minute.
Dear friend, Dr. Vijay Kirtan. Is it okay? Everybody able to hear? Thank you. My very dear friend, Dr. Kirtan, chairman of the Institute, director, Dr. Roy, Dr. Radha Chelliah's family, and distinguished friends. At the outset, I am very happy today to see such a gathering of friends and people whom I have known for 50 years
Hillary, and apart from the people with whom I acquired and work. So I think just, I can't conceive, but I don't know how to express my delight, my joy, my pleasure, my happiness to see all my friends here. And I'm grateful to you, sir, Dr. Kerrigan, for giving me this opportunity to meet and be with my friends. At the outset, I express my deep debt of gratitude to NIPFP for inviting me to deliver the prestigious Dr. Raja Chelliah Memorial Lecture. Dr. Chelliah combined in himself a popular teacher, a deep scholar, a builder of institution, a policymaker, and above all, a gentleman. I'm aware that in this gathering, there are several people to whom he has been a benefactor. We are fortunate that Dr. Chelliah built this world-class institution, one of the very few institutions in India that can claim an international stature. Credit should also go to the successive chairman who have contributed to the outstanding performance of Dr. Chelliah's creation. So I think this is a good opportunity for us to express our appreciation to all the chairman and directors who have kept up their high standards of this institution. Fiscal and monetary policies are two pillars of macro economic policy, both for accelerating growth and ensuring stability. Their relative roles and the nature of interface have been of great interest to both academics and policy makers. But the narrative of academicians on the subject and policy makers may not be the same as that of the practitioners. And I quote from one of my colleagues in the RDI, from an article we wrote, quote, "Whereas theories raise fundamental questions about the functioning of the system and enunciated model or behavioral loss under certain assumptions, practitioners generally rely on historical perspective and experience as guideposts. Policies are more often based upon sound judgments and taking into account the economic milieu in combination with socio-political compulsion and circumstances. Therefore, from policies evolve contextually to the particular environment. Naturally, policies cannot be understood or explained without reference to geographical location, historical context, and overall environment. I intend, therefore, presenting before you a practitioner's perspective of how the interface evolved in our country, as on both sides, if not three sides of the day. I will briefly recall the pre-reform status of the interface from 1950 to 1991. Then this will be followed by a detailed account of the manner in which the interface between fiscal and monetary was transformed during 1991 to 2003. The transformation was through mutual consultation between government and RBI. This framework of interface was supplemented by unconventional measures between 2003 and 2008. It was put to test after the global financial crisis, something that was experienced in other countries as well. This stressful interface between 2008 and 2015 in India has been replaced by an entirely new framework in 2016. I propose to suggest that the new framework is in some ways a continuation of the past and new in some fundamental ways. The new framework is closer to theory than before and is closer to the practice being followed in advanced economies. Thus, there is a double convergence as far as the new framework is concerned. Keeping in view my experience in the past and taking advantage of consultations with eminent economists, I shall attempt to list the path ahead in a summarized manner. Looking ahead, I do sense that there are some important broader systemic aspects that should be visited and more with more attention and deliberation than they have received so far. I will skip some of the passages. First, I want to pre-reform. I think most of us are aware that pre-reform, essentially, the plan priorities will determine the disposition of credit. And the money, so in the first instance, the controlled expense of money. After some time, the government started indulging in quote-unquote the deficit financing as a means of financing the plan, because it's capital expenditure and the medium term denying it. So first stage, it became money as part of the plan, then after consultations were held, but actual deficit financing increased. And that had to be automatically monetized. So after this stage, what has happened, there's no control of monetary expansion, but control of the damage that has been done. Because it is unexpected, unanticipated, uncontrolled expansion. So that was the thing that happened. And the way the money had to be created, first of all, you have, the RBI had to create money whenever the government wanted to get deficit financing. Then the financial institutions came, IDBA, and it had to create money for this. Not that it was reluctant at that point of time, but it also recognized there was an accepted position that RBI will share when you are partnered with the government in handling both supply and demand. So they have to manage aggregate demand, they have to promote the supply. So that was the sort of overlap that was happening. There's a combined effort. And then in 1969, banks were nationalized. With the nationalization of banks, you had an interesting situation where in the financial system market to be active. And then you had a joint family where you did not necessarily account for transactions. So then you have a banking system, then you have an RBI, and then you have a government. And and at the same time, development of loans were floated. And I must share a couple of experiences here. In 1967, as sub-collector of gold, I was asked to collect money informally by the government, informally, from people, rice millers, ration shops, etc. Because we have to subsidize the government borrowing. The government bonds had to issue development loans, yes. The government loans. So having the artificial low interest rate for government bonds is not new. In 1967, unofficial, the receipts were issued, but it's unofficial. The money there. So we hand over the subsidized amount to select people who buy the bonds because the market rate of that. So we lived through that. And then we come to 1972-73. After nationalization of banks, it's not as though we resisted, especially after 69. Then we had every state was encouraged to have a commissioner of institutional finance. Because the development had to be funded government plus the institution. And the institutions again went bank or the development. So the whole approach was that and this is nothing, not that there was any resistance, but everybody thought that's a good thing to do, and that's what we're doing. So this sort of thing went on up to 1980. And as we approached 1980, the basic problem for us, the basic task of RBI was to control the damage. This is uncontrolled expansion, they can only try to control. By then 1980s, we had a problem. By the time 80s came, market borrowing also increased. So that the market borrowing increased, there was a virtual automatic monetization. And there was use of every institution to expand the credit. And then the RBI came into the mode of controlling the damage. So the situation came into controlling the damage. And that meant a huge strain on the economy. And that's where finally, and in fact, what happened was in 1980s, the amount of deficit financing over and above what was approved in the plan was so high, the Chief Minister Reddy demanded the states would get a share of the excess deficit financing of the plan. He said, look, this is what we approved. In the National Development Council, we approved this. This is the plan. And this is the deficit financing. That's why we approved it. If you're going to have more deficit financing, give me my share. And so that was because it was very, very high. and of course I have partly to that effect. So, there's another interesting thing is by mid-1980s, it was very clear that things were very difficult. But then the political situation was such, even when the political leadership accepted there is a problem, it's not easy to pull to a solution. But at a technical level, and you know, Mr. Mankamishi, as far as monetary policy is concerned, we had to form a Sukumai Chakravarti Committee. So Sukumai Chakravarti Committee gave on the whole money supply, and they gave the whole idea of operating on the monetary aggregates. So you have the monetary aggregates very well done. The problem was that you can have monetary aggregate fixed, but how do you restrict the government? And it was interesting that this aspect, which was raised in mid-1980s, was actually raised in 1977. In all the plan discussions that Rajkrishna was there, and Narasimha Reddy briefed the governor. Rajkrishna asked according to the history value, so why not have a monthly target and then skip this? So he said, yes, but if I can bounce the government of India's check. If I can refuse to honor the check of government of India, there's nothing that I can do. It is silly. It must. So that was the state of affairs. And the RBI had to increase the preemption. The statute is the issue. So at one stage it reached, I think, 60%. 60% of the total deposits of banks were preempted for the banking system to maintain a reasonable borrowing cost. So this sums up the situation, and this is, which is what, 1991, there was a paradigm shift in the interface as part of the reform which commenced in 1991. At a very broad level, the paradigm shift occurred through a series, I would say, of acts of abnegation of power by the government to RBI and the markets. I think this is the significance. The power was concentrated. In this 12 years, 1991 to 2003, the power was surrendered virtually through mutual consultation to the RBI and to the markets. And how it is done is very important, because it is as much as management and administration and economics and politics. Now, what did we do actually in substance? First, there was an end to the automatic monetization of government deficits. Second, fiscal rules were put in place for the enactment of fiscal responsibility. All this happened in 2 4 years, but this is a fundamental thing. And of course, you were the finance secretary when you pushed him into the finance minister's speech. Third, the exit from the financial repression commenced. This SLR started coming down. Fourth, a decision was taken to eliminate, at least try eliminating, and I think Ashram Sinhaji asked me to head of the committee, to eliminate administered interest rates. Fifthly, providing refinance by RBI to various entities was gradually phased out. The idea was whatever money is to create, we'll create. If necessary, we'll give it to the government. And you give it to them, but we don't have to source it. Finally, the policy of transfer of profits to the government from the Reserve Bank of India, out of the surplus, was rationalized and made formula-based. Finally, the separation of debt office from the RBI was proposed by the Reserve Bank of India, subject to fulfillment of the conditions. Of course, many of these reforms are still in progress, a little slow progress after 2010, if I may submit. I moved to the Reserve Bank of India. In this business, I was got involved, and I moved to the Reserve Bank of India from Ministry of Finance in 1996. And I think this story is very well known. The first agreement was signed by Dr. Nagarajan. And then the question, so there is a limit. Now, having fixed a limit, how do you operationalize it? So what do? You go back to National Rajkrishna question. So you have to get a second agreement, where it says this is the amount, ways and means advance. And then the finance ministry asks the same question, right? What do you do? How will you impose a ways and means advance on us? So I had to explain, because I saw the agreement. They said, don't worry, we enter into the agreement. And whenever your limit of ways and means limit of 75% is reached, I'll make sure you get money. Said, why? I'm not getting manager. I want that debt for you. So then the idea was that I'm a debt manager. So I took upon myself the responsibility of getting debt from wherever I do the raising a bond to you. So that you won't. Then of course the political economy issue came, we lose. So, but no, it's very difficult. I said, no, in fact, it's central to finance ministry. Because we're going to tell the other ministries that the checkmate bonds, this one is going to create trouble, so don't worry. So, anyway, finally, it was possible to get into this agreement because, most important, there was an assurance that there will not be any serious, and it was built into the agreement itself, that it will be triggered. Anyway, it's our responsibility. Now, in due course, it was decided mutually. Earlier, the RBI itself used to buy the bonds and the primary issuance itself. So actually, you're also in the market buying the bonds. You're the debt manager. That was the practice. Because otherwise, you couldn't raise the money. You just couldn't raise the money. So then we said, no, we won't do involve as primary issues. We'll do only secondary. Now, but how do you sell? So we have to create primary dealers, give them the money, and make them buy this. But at least, slowly, you have to bring into marketization. An extremely unviable situation. So this is how we provided money to primary dealers, gave them special treatment, etc. Not unheard of in the world, but we have to do that. Then the most important thing is that all this was done without legal provisions. This was settled, practiced, and after that we said, okay, now let's put it into law. But one thing I always believe is that law enables some things, law prohibits some things, but most of the good things can be done without reference to law. So if you understand that 90% of the economic reforms do not require legal changes. And I can prove separately if I'm asked to write a book. Now, so what we did, we wanted to bring it into the law. Now, how do you bring it? The government was keen on FRBM. If you are clear on FRBM, you put this in. So normally the restriction on the financing of the government by the RBI is a prohibition put on RBI in the RBI Act. In India, you will find it in the FRBM Act, where the government says you don't finance me, okay? So that is the law to find here in the FRBM. Okay. Now having done that, we had also looked at the balance sheet. The balance sheet became important because once you have this whole system. Now the balance sheet again had two problems. I'm going to detail because this is the way that the interface works. There are two problems. One is the legacy problem, the other is the future. The legacy problem, we had, I think, 170,000 crores or something in those days of treasury bills. That means 4.5% interest rate, market interest rate 8%, no maturity. So once we went to the auditor, said, we must fill up the balance sheet. I said, okay, we can do that mark to market. So last is 80,000 crores, ask the government to give you. So there's no way. So the way we did it is then we got into the agreement and I said that we will convert the set of presidency to marketable securities. That means the interest rate is higher. But I'm holding it, so whatever interest you pay me, you'll get you back as profit. It's profit. So I'll make a separate account for it, I'll give it back to you. The advantage is whenever the market opens, I can sell this. And this helped us in operations years later than I got the capital. And we are perhaps the only country who could absorb 10% of GDP of capital flows in 1 year. And this was available when required. Okay. Now again, this is an arrangement of, and later I come to the significance of the whole thing. Incidentally, the issue of transfer of surpluses to reserves. So the criteria, we work on the criteria, we got global experience, and then we said what's our circumstance, committee put it in public domain. Under law, Board of RBI has to approve. How much is required for the reserves? They take the reserves and the rest goes to the government. That's the law. It's the board which decides. But anyway, we said that it's a policy. And then the audit also agreed, we went to the board. But as usual, before I go to the board, I get the blessings of the government of India. So I went to the government of India, we explained. And then every time the query was coming for finally, I went back and I said, in fact, market was the answer that I paid for it. And after some time, I was a little tired, money supply. So money, I don't know, tell me, if you have financing, do you agree? I said, yes. And that's how you got the name. So we have an unjoked. And that's a tough thing. The whole point was there was a formula. It was built with analysis. And so that's how we arrived in the formula at that point of time, which has been operating for almost 20 years. Now, then came the question of banks. So that was another funny legacy problem. Government of India at that time had to recapitalize banks, and they had to recapitalize banks without increasing the fiscal deficit. So how do you do that? So the government of India went on giving the equity to the banks and asked the banks to buy bonds. And bonds, some rate was fixed, some maturity was fixed through bilateral negotiation. And the banks also were told that we repay when we want to, so it's not marketable. So that was the arrangement. That was how they recapitalized. Now my problem was that this is not the way you run a modern system. So how do you ensure? So we negotiated and told the banks that look, we will get converted into marketable securities. And the government will have to pay higher interest than it should. But we said from time to time. So over a period, we got rid of all this disrupted private capitalist recapitalization wanted of the banks, they became marketable securities. In fact, anyway, the supply part, government security was increasing, which we wanted to develop. If you wanted to develop, you require money markets and governance. Because most important, fiscal policy and what's it, monetary policy. Fiscal policy, monetary policy interface across to financial sector. And I think that's a critical part. Otherwise, the interface in the market economy depends on the way your financial sector works. I'll come back to later. In this period of reforms, a monetary targeting framework was actually pursued. The M3 target showed a secular decline. The administered interest rates were rationalized. The statutory preemption were reduced from 63% in 1992 to 35%. And I think after 1998 till now, we have been able to reduce it to 47%. Bank rate was activated for refinancing purposes. The development of money markets and government security markets took place. Now, who should take credit for this transformation of fiscal monetary interface? It is a watershed in the economic history of India. The credit should go to four prime ministers. Four prime ministers who were prepared to hand over the power of the government to the RBI in the market. It goes to four finance ministers of all formations, Congress, BJP, third, and a series of secretaries, whether they take Pelcher or BSM, that didn't make a difference. So that is the main point I want to make, is the interface between fiscal and monetary policy is essentially a political economy issue. Fiscal policy always has gainers and losers. Monetary policy has gainers and losers. So this interface itself is a political economy issue. And the extent to which it should be apolitical. What the extent to which this interface should be apolitical is itself a political economy issue. So technocrats like us can only facilitate, can promote, can sell, but we can't make it happen. I think that's the thing I just want to mention before I go to the next stage. Having done this, we thought that now we have settled the matter, we've got an ideal framework, let the government sort it out, and then what happens? And then in the meantime, what we did, I came back to government. So I got now pushy head, but the problem, we got an unanticipated problem, no interface framework could anticipate that we'll be getting too much money. And that started coming. So then we had a situation, what do we do? So we decided on two things. One, the framework inherently is good enough, and therefore all the proposals which are already pending about the RBI, amendments to RBI Act, amendments to BR Act, to formalize, to legalize the practices should be continued. and they are all done. And then we produce quote unquote some unconventional measures to take care of this unanticipated problem, which we did not expect to last forever. It is temporary problem, maybe 2 years, maybe 3 years. We require unconventional measures, we should do that. So that was the strategy, it is a two. Carl said, the fundamental framework we didn't want to disturb. Now what did we do? Then one of the normal process of 15 indirect instruments, namely liquidity adjustment facility, we completed it. We intended the market stabilization scheme. So basically under the scheme, the operational autonomy of RBI, I think I told you the story, that we said we went to government and said that look, up to a point, that is the liquidity adjustment facility is for operational purposes. If there's excess capital flow, it's huge liquidity. So we try to make a distinction between normal liquidity and extraordinary. I said normal is something which RBI can handle. Extraordinary is something that I can't handle as a sovereign man. So when this was put up to the government, and I wanted the government to say that you tell me how much is the ceiling. I will operate on your account for money. So you borrow money and don't use it. That's what I will first say, but you do it on your account so that you know the pain of capital upon you. You want more capital, then you pay for it. Unless you are prepared to allow the exchange rate. So this is the only way I could handle it. And naturally, first round the government rejected. On the advice of the chief economic advisor. So then I was told that this erodes the economy and independence. I don't want independence. I don't want the economy, please. You don't give me the economy. And therefore, it was approved. And so every time the ceiling had to be approved. This was unique. Now, I will quote from a currency and finance report of 2013, RBI currency and finance report, and I quote. A large number of countries such as Chile, China, Colombia, Indonesia, Korea, Malaysia, Peru, Philippines, Russia, Sri Lanka, Taiwan, and Thailand have issued central bank securities. However, the central banks of many of these countries face deterioration in their balance sheet. What happens when your balance sheet deteriorates? You go to the government and beg. So instead of going to beg when I am weak, I go to start begging you before I become weak. Okay? As simple as that. So as such, the MSS continues. However, the central banks of many of these countries face deterioration in their balance sheets. As such, the MSS considerably enhanced the degree of freedom for monetary policy. It strengthened the Reserve Bank's ability to conduct exchange rate monetary management operations. It also enabled the Reserve Bank to use the MSS tool flexibly to both absorb and impart liquidity later. After the global crisis, these MSS were unlocked. This is the compensated level, which was created jointly and not independently. Now, let me come to the global crisis and stress. The global crisis, now that's a different ballgame. Fortunately, I handed over in 2 weeks in advance of the global crisis. The global crisis compelled coordinated fiscal monetary actions in all countries. And in India was no exception. It had to be done, and this is again. But the problem is there's a stress now. There's a stress in the sense that when there's a problem and everybody wants liquidity, financial markets want liquidity, government wants liquidity, they use liquidity, then everybody is happy. Full coordination within the country, among the countries, G20, everything's fine. But it breaks down for two reasons, which was to be expected. When there's uneven recovery in different countries, because uneven initial conditions, then they cannot synchronize this exit. First problem. The second and more important problem is in the coordination within the country, always there is a resistance in one, as you know, in one business cycle, there is a resistance in another, they are happy, and that's what we are also. The central bank, as you know, would like to exit. At a particular point of time, and usually the perception, the government is no, it's not necessary to exit now. And so, nothing very unusual in our country also, first coordinated response, later uncoordinated response. So then you get into this problem. So but here in India, these developments led to questioning the monetary policy framework itself that was in place. So this in mind was a natural stress, but still that was questioned. And finally, there is a new framework. And now that becomes a new framework. The conduct of monetary policy in India, so therefore, is transformation in 2014. transitioning to inflexible inflation targeting framework. So during 2014-15, I think the formal architecture for flexible inflation targeting came. I don't have to explain, you are more up to date than this and the time. But the main thing is the primary objective was defined as price stability. That's the primary objective. The RBA was act was amended. Then there's inflation. So one objective, primary objective, primary. Second, inflation targeting. And third is the interest rate is the instrument. So that's basically the architecture. And the monetary policy committee will have representatives of the government. So this is what I'm called the new formal fiscal and monetary framework for the interface in India provides greater clarity than ever before on the respective role of monetary and fiscal authorities. We now have a rule-based fiscal policy mandated by FRBM Act, thanks to Reddy, and a rule-based monetary policy through the amended RBA Act. So we have both rule-based in many sectors. There are elements of continuity in this. And then I come to the next chapter. The continuity is, in some ways, the Monetary Policy Committee is an extension of something that we was put in place a few years before. Technical Advisory Committee in Monetary Policy. But the committee should be there, the governor cannot handle it alone. So a committee was formed, except the composition of the committee was different, more broad-based, and now the committee is economic. At that time, it was more broad-based, including the members of the board. So in a way, the committee should be as better wisdom, greater wisdom, and is reliable than individual governor was already accepted. So that continues. Again, in the inflation surveys were started before, and self-imposed inflation target was again articulated. So the idea of some sort of an inflation target is also there. And so therefore, in some senses, broadly, in principle, this is a framework that was accepted. Informal but not formal, that's the difference. So there was what they knew framework. Generally, there were impressive. Now let's go back to the global situation and how I want to say how this continuity and mandate is a convergence with the global. So what are the global consensus before the crisis? There was a very impressive convergence between academics and policymakers. Another thing, very often it's a divergence. But in the global economy, in the late 1990s, there's a convergence among the economists, particularly and central bank practitioners and the academics. And let me quote Professor Goodhart, my guru. According to Goodhart, there are three key tenets around which he calls it the coalition of academics and practitioners has been formed. And this he gave a basis of my work about. First, the monetary authority's primary objective is to price stability. This was in 2000, this summer. Second, the central bank should have sufficient independence to vary its operational instrument without fear of failure. And third, its main, almost its only such instrument in its control was short-term interest rates. And that was the wisdom, 2000, as I said, was a good end. At that time, India did not subscribe to these views. We, in our way, looked at multiple indicators of the economy's conditions and gave importance to price stability, but not as the primary objective of all time. We emphasized the coordination of policies in view of the structural transformation underway in our country and complexities in our economic system. Our instrument was not confined to interest rate, though gradually it became the primary instrument. We did not hesitate to use several instruments, namely direct and indirect instruments, as well as regulatory actions. The reform process and the policy actions to meet immediate challenges were coordinated, resulting in multiple objectives with a focus on price and financial stability. Multiple instruments were used to assure price and financial stability, and these were not restricted to monetary policy instruments. So the global consensus, which was reinforced at that time, by what was called a great moderation, prevailed until the onset of the global financial crisis. This is the reason. After the experience of global financial crisis, there was a slight change. Inflation targeting approach was diluted to make it flexible. The single objective was supplemented with consideration of financial stability. Independence of central banks is now subject to orientation in favor of coordination with other agencies. in particular government. So there's a slight nuance that has happened at the global level. The new framework adopted by India shows convergence in the current global consensus. In the current global consensus is not the purist now, it's slightly diluted, and on the interface. So I'm not referring to the relative emphasis between fiscal and monetary on which the matter is yet to be resolved over there. But the issue of framework is what I'm referring to. So we're closer. India is now closer to the global consensus. There's also a convergence of RBA framework with practitioners of other countries. Actually, if you say number of countries, and as the annual report of RBA itself says, we are now in the group of many countries, advanced economies. So in that there is double convergence as far as the framework is concerned. Now, what are the tasks ahead? There are tasks ahead, I think, fairly well known. But I think to have a good grip over the tasks ahead, so we should be up to date on the subject, and which has not been away in Hyderabad, not in Delhi or Bombay. So what I did was, so I went to Professor Govindra, who is always around and everywhere, and I said, so let us discuss. And we discussed, and then said, oh, this should be the task ahead. So they are listed, so you can read it from the paper. I won't waste your time. But I will conclude with what I may say are some of my thoughts on the subject. So I call it looking at it. So I'm just looking at it. Looking ahead beyond the debates on economic reforms, there are important areas that warrant attention by fiscal and monetary authorities in their joint efforts to enhance growth and ensure stability. These relate to external sector, fiscal assessment, financial system, and possible risks. Experience has shown that external sector balance is critical for our economy. We have paid a heavy price when there was stress in the external sector. I believe that external balance is a public good which can best be delivered only by RBI. The short-term political considerations may not be, may avoid focus on this. There's nobody else. So that's my personal proposition. So I may be inclined to emphasize it more. But now, all indications are that the global economy is still under stress. Economic activity is expected to be sluggish in the short term and is not expected to pick up significantly in the near term. The political developments in the United States may have repercussions in the policy of the US Fed. The US Fed, according to law, is expected to keep the interest of the US, and they have to serve the interest of the US economy. And they are accountable. So now I presume that the US Fed will have to make sure that they are accountable. And then the balance between, see, always there is a balance between domestic consideration, global consideration, which will in turn affect the US economy. But in that assessment, if you are accountable and if a legal mandate is that, then one should not be surprised with the weight of considerations if a slightly varies and we go forward. Now, what does it mean? It means that if there is some doubt in the rest of the country for the rule of the currency also, then there is alternative currency. There is no agreed alternative currency. So only then can we expand the currency basket. Now, if the world wants to expand the currency basket, what is the next available currency? India. So if that comes, what is the stand of India? Has China benefited by doing whatever it did, becoming an SDR? So this is something which at some stage I have discussed informally. I myself am not sure. But I think this is something, and this has a lot of implications for our monetary and fiscal management. So this is one thing which I want to say looking ahead. You may have to analyze how these global developments will impact, because the relative importance will have to increase as we move along. The financial system. The financial system is critical to the interface between fiscal and monetary policy, as you mentioned. India is a bank-dominated economy. And in the short to medium term, it is unlikely to change. Transmission of monetary policy depends on banks, and in particular on their ownership and governance structure. and functioning. Many risks with regard to public sector banks rest with the sovereign. The incentive structure for the institution, as well as the management and staff, are not in alignment with market incentives. In brief, the normal assumption when a regulator, when a monetary policy, monetary authority, when they take monetary policy decisions, the decisions assume that the regulated entities respond to market signals. That's a fundamental basis on which all the policy decisions are taken. Now here, such an assumption in the conduct of monetary policy that the regulated entities would respond to market signals may not be very realistic. And then you do not know what assumptions to make. That's problem. From the public sector bank point of view, there are serious problems. From HSLR, CRR, priority sector lending, and then other lending, etc. Now, the common thread in Indian situation, for many reasons, the common thread between fiscal policy, monetary policy, and financial sector is public sector hands. That is the common thread. Nothing can be effective. In fact, we have a tax of public sector banks, both service and corporate tax, which is future. Look, so the future of the financial system, and indeed modernization of financial sector of India, depends on how we overcome the intractable problem of the public sector banks. I don't know how to call it, intractable or something like that. Okay. But there seems to be a political economy consensus. There's a political economy consensus that as far as possible, don't do anything for public sector. So that is the problem. In my view, the future of the modernization of the financial sector and therefore a modern economy will depend on the way the public sector banks issue is sorted. A critical input in the fiscal monetary policy interface is the assumptions regarding the fiscal deficit. So here the point is, normally the Reserve Bank of India makes its own assessment of the fiscal, likely fiscal path. So there is a budget announcement, and always the governor has to say, yes, we believe that's correct, it's correct in general. So, but you make your own assumption. That's why they call it assessment. It is an assumption that's an assessment. So now, I'm sure that there is a MPC, they will be making an assessment, as it was before. I'm sure they do that. Now, then the uncertainty regarding transfer surplus is a very important link, because it has something to do with the profit of the independence of the central bank, that still persists. Technically, it is possible to take the stand that a central bank need not worry about capital, in much as the government would always repatriate it. But basically, it's better. You can take everything, or you can have principal. But an in-between uncertainty is not good. That's the only thing I'm going to say. Now, let me concluding remarks before you give me a paper. So these are the concluding remarks. Traditionally, the debate in the context of monetary policy has been a choice between rule versus discretion, committee versus individual, targeting versus non-targeting, and independence versus coordination. The global financial crisis has shown that the reality is more nuanced. A reality is that of balance. The buzzwords now are constrained discretion, flexible rules, and flexible inflation targeting. Similarly, there is an increasing emphasis on coordination along with independence. Increasingly, monetary policy is becoming more of an art, even if it is not less of a science. Let me conclude with a word of optimism. All the members nominated to the Monetary Policy Committee of the Reserve Bank are economists with impeccable integrity, professional credentials, and a reputation for independent thinking. I could not have picked a better team. We are in very safe hands. Thank you very much.
Dr. Reddy agreed to take a few questions You have a limited question, it's two questions only. So floor is open. Thoughts, sir?
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Reddy, thank you for this splendid talk. My question is about a problem now. What advice would you offer for the recapitalization of the banking system in at this moment and thus dealing with bad debts?
To be very frank, there are two issues. One is the balance sheet issue, and the other is the substantial issue. So substantial issues require a lot of better blend. So I think that's something where a lot of action has to take place in the final analysis. And anything there's a shock for, you can come back to the topic. Whatever way you do it, so you have to divide the system, and that's a matter of detail. But as far as the balance sheet is concerned, it is owned by the government, basically, predominantly owned by the government. So if you, and whatever way you do, when you recap, then you are taking the risk transfer. So in other words, you get whatever money you raise, or even what the earlier recapitalization, you are replacing, you are basically acquiring equity position and taking over all the risks. So that's, and whatever you take is a matter of detail. One wants to put there, how you can put the reserves and whatever is there, you get that again. But essentially what you are doing is you are putting your resources as equity to an enterprise where you are not giving incentives so that it does not occur in the future. And I think Sudhupo is here, we spent some time on this. The sheer fiscal, adverse fiscal impact of the public sector banks and the public enterprises is huge. And I think the suggestion was made that it should be commissioned just to say, what is the fiscal cost? I think all I can say is that somebody, a lot of, but look at it differently. Where will the risk lie? Essentially, it should come back to government. Where does it come back? Public sector banks? Public-private partnership? Public-private partnership is a special purpose vehicle. So the company's balance sheet is only, does not, it is only the balance sheet, but the SPV is no, it has no stake. The SPV is between the government and the private party. Private party has no stake. And this SPV has taken loan from the bank. And the bank is owned by the government. So essentially, all these risks, even if you take a squeeze, they are essentially concentrated. The cumulative risk in this on the sovereign in India due to the combination of the real sector, the financial sector interface is huge. There's some assessment. And that is what I partly meant when I said assessment of the financial sector. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Known for the certainty autonomy of the RBI, and your lecture also proved that you have taken many decisions of that kind. One is reminded of the conversation between Chief Deshmukh and Jawaharlal Nehru. When Chief Deshmukh became chairman of the UGC, he asked, is it autonomous? He said, you assert your autonomy, I will respect it. So what was your experience after asserting the autonomy? And secondly, what do you feel is the present scenario about the relationship between autonomy? You know, the world is having a cycle of liberalization, globalization, and then protectionism. Are you seeing that the whole system of trade and financial system is going back to the system of inward looking and not less of globalization? Thirdly, you have made a number of startling recommendations on statistical system when we were together on the statistical commission. Are you satisfied with what has happened later, or you have left it to Dr. Bhagwan to take care of it now? Thank you.
As far as, first I started to joke about I think I said before also, I was asked when I was going also, like, are you, is RBI independent? Are you independent? I said, yes, I am independent. RBI is independent. I have taken the permission of my finance minister to tell you. And I think mean it in a blue strategy. The Reserve Bank of India is created by the government. It is the philosophically what the government, and especially if you see the debates also going up in 1930, this issue came, and operationally the problem came in 1970 after Vietnam. The whole issue becomes, there's no bad. But anyway, that's the philosophical issue. The point is that there are two things which are required to run a modern financial system. That people should have basic trust in money and finance, number one. And secondly, partly for that purpose, if the money creation and money spending authority is the same, that trust may be diluted. So conveniently, the governments create a reserve bank, central bank. And they say central bank is independent. These have trust in money and finance. Will they create money? And they are apolitical, they are technical, they are independent. So that's how it is sold. But having created, they would like to, and they would like any government, they would like to use the RBI and say that you do this, you do this, you do this. Now from a Reserve Bank of point of view, they have to convince the public they are autonomous, etc. But they have to earn their autonomy in the negotiations with the minister. So essentially, otherwise they are not effective. So essentially, what to harmonize? Operational autonomy is where you can say, look, this, whether it's 5.25, this and that you can keep negotiating. So that is part of the principle. Second, RBI is not just monetary authority. RBI is a debt manager. You are a debt manager, how are you independent? You are a banker, how are you independent? So different functions have different type of relationship with RBI. It's an oversimplification.
Last question.
Earlier question, which is around the public sector banks, and we talked about them being the fulcrum of interface between monetary and fiscal policy. And the real question I have for you is, it's been an age-old problem and well known that the governance of the PSUs is fundamentally the challenge. The political capital and will required to transform that structure, as you mentioned, is really going to decide the modern financial system in this country. And how do you think that's going to evolve? Because fundamentally, if you look at today, India's investment to GDP ratio, if something has to change, that has to be the beginning of that change. Otherwise, 7 years from now, we'd be saddled with the same problem at the turn of another commodity cycle or an infrastructure boom. So what would be your advice?
I think at one stage, Mr. Ashwin Sinha even made a parliamentary commitment of dilution of debt, which itself is a solution of problem. The political economy consensus is not a value, as simple as that, as I mentioned. There is no political economy consensus on handling this problem, despite particularly cost to the system. That really is the big question. For way ahead, for all the financial sector, fiscal, and monetary policy, all of them will be constrained till this problem is solved. That's all I can say.
Well, friends, let me first thank Dr. Reddy for a very illuminating and thoughtful lecture. The director asked me to do my some remarks, and I think I'll be very brief. I just thought that Dr. Reddy quite rightly mentioned that the way the coordination of the government and the central bank of the system and the market takes place are both formal and informal. And I want to give you an example of informal one, which Reddy may recall. It was on 19 May 2004 when government changed. If you remember, suddenly the Indian government lost its majority and there was a possibility of coalition government in which Communist Party would play an important role, possibly emerge. And he was reformed and he gave a statement which completely reacted the markets. And there was mayhem in the market. And I was at that time Minister of Finance and probably know the governor. I got a call that was first came from the Congress headquarters that it's important that the minister, finance minister must give a statement. So I went to Justin Secretary that said you must give a statement, calm the market because there's a panic. So it would be I can't have just submitted the resignation of president. I just came back with the Prime Minister, we had given the resignation of president, So I have no capacity now to issue a statement. Then I called the Mumbai and requested the government to make a statement of satellite liquidity in the market, and which I postponed they did. And then I called Dr. Manmohan Singh and said, please issue a statement because this is not the only place that I'm a power. I'm not in the government. It was an incoming government to issue a statement. And then Manmohan Singh gave a statement and which completely calmed the mind. So many times the coordination takes place really in a very informal manner, which has mutual trust is involved. And I was very sort of solid. We got a lady, we were telling that we supply what is liquidity required in the market, and that will become the market. So, second is that whichever the finance minister I worked with in the finance minister, there is one thing I recognize that RBI is an anchor of the system, and it is respected and cultivated and nurtured. So there is a I don't think any single finance minister has any notion which is to disturb in any way the role and importance of RBI and the maintained good governor and the prime minister. So not just formal framework is important, but I think the mutual trust, mutual respect is probably as important as the first or second or third law of process would have is the fourth law. Finally, what matters is the mutual trust and mutual respect. So, Dr. Reddy, once again on my behalf and on behalf of everyone here, I would thank you for this absolutely wonderful lecture, and it will be studied for many, many years to come. And you already have sort of given me an interesting homework to be done in NIPFP, and we would start working on what you've asked, look at the fiscal costs of the banking sector, and we probably hopefully do it in a few months, because by skillful managing budget, Dr. Roy has enabled to create some part of money which we can do research on our own, So on this, I think NIPFP will do research, and probably the earliest opportunity will come back to you, take your guidance on the kind of work we have done. So friends, please join me to give a warm hand to Dr.
Thank you for deciding to come here excited. Doing something that he said. Dr. Reddy, you'll be very happy to know that there are two very happy people in this room who you have contributed profusely to in your speech. Two of our independent members of the Monetary Policy Committee and the audience. So that was quite nice to see that happen. Great time, it's very important, I guess. My big takeaway is that on public sector banks, sir, we are and have actually brought out a paper by Professor Ajay Chhabra, which estimates at least the PSPR. And now we're trying to break that down to look at public sector banking. So he's already leading the project, which should complete in the next 6 to 8 months. So we should have information on that. But that, yeah, I mean, we have a whole three-phased, funded by an IPFP project. So that's important. And I think that's where our fiscal accounting is incomplete. So I hope we can do it. But then, we do it faster than any other practice. Okay, thank you very much. And on that note, let us build trust between ourselves and conviviality. So we please invite you all for dinner, which is around the corner. Thank you.